In medieval European history, it began as a mystery from the east, overland along the Silk Road, and then in ships from across the sea. There were strange rumors of sickness, stories of great masses of the dead, and by 1347, the Great Pestilence was a reality in Western Europe and many other parts of the world. This is Dr. Katherine Bankole-Medina with a podcast on the Great Plague of Dark Ages Europe, Notes from the History of Disease. This podcast provides a basic overview of medical health and well-being in the Western European Middle Ages, summarizes the Great Plague, and notes some of the social aspects of the outbreak. Our focus is largely on the latter Middle Ages, from approximately the mid-1300s. Now, it is also important to mention that given the scholarly controversy over the Black Death as either bubonic plague or viral hemorrhagic fever, we take the position that the etiology of the disease, in terms of historical study, is no less important than the impact. In addition, the close relationship between the bubonic plague and hemorrhagic infection is so similar in human destruction during the Western European Middle Ages that we support the multiple bubonic strain theory, which has been offered by some scholars. You can write the history of humanity through man's desire to heal sickness and to maintain optimal physical health and well-being. Man has always lived with parasites and bacteria and the threat of disease. We know that prehistoric man actively attempted to stave off disease and practice medicine. He practiced trepanation, which is the oldest surgical procedure, in order to alleviate illnesses associated with the brain. However, man's direct and cultivated relationship with animals and the natural environment truly changed the world. The domestication of plants and animals had a tremendous impact on the advancement of medical knowledge. Plants brought about new ways to treat illness, and the use of livestock facilitated a higher quality of life. Another result was the exchange of infection between animals and humans, as well as the mutation of disease. The vast period in medieval European history, known as the Dark Ages, was the period from the fall of Rome in the 6th century through the beginning of the Italian Renaissance in the 14th century. These Dark Ages included the early waves of northern and western barbarian invasions, the loss of classical Roman civilization, and the general decay and decline of Western European society. It was a time of slavery and serfdom, where the majority of people worked the land as the perpetual labor foundation for feudalism. It was also a time of violent competition for power among the nobility and the warrior knights, a time when the weakened Church of Rome advanced the peace of God and the truce of God in an attempt to control the warring nobility, and also to curb theft and assaults on the people, and to eliminate fighting on religious high holy days. In this time of lawlessness, people developed interdependent relationships for protection, to generate wealth, and for mutual support, for mere survival. The European Middle Ages saw countless wars, the Norman conquests, the wars of investitures, the 100 Years' War, among many other conflicts. This age also included 9 crusades, with Pope Urban II calling to arms soldiers to claim the Holy Land, Damascus, Jerusalem, and Palestine, and this was his effort to resurrect Western Christendom in these areas. In the mid-14th century, One of the most destructive diseases in human history, commonly called the Black Death, reached Western Europe, and it represented the second major pandemic in world history. While the mortality rate often varies, it was massive in this part of the world, up to 50% with a projected 200 million victims. The witnesses to this devastating disease did not commonly refer to it as the Black Death. They called it the Great Pestilence, the Mortality, and the Great Plague, among other names. Subsequent chroniclers and scholars called the bubonic plague the Black Death because of the skin discolorations and eruptions that appeared on the body, often signaling swift and certain mortality. People thought it was the end of the world. In human history, plagues often give rise to prophets, prophecies, and superstition. The bubonic plague was quixotic, with the highest mortality among the poor and elderly, and the nobility and the clergy were stricken. Long before its appearance in Western Europe in 1347, people in Eurasia began to notice and make connections to the various outbreaks of disease with weather patterns, especially those that affected the crops. From the medieval European perspective, these observations moved from east to west and included such natural disasters as drought, floods, hurricanes, meteorites, and even earthquakes. There were also stories of ghost ships, vessels aimlessly roaming the seas, harboring crews who were victims of the great pestilence, ships with crew members who exhibited obvious plague symptoms were denied debarkation. Influencing these tales of climatic and supernatural causes for the great pestilence was the reality of death carters, the reality of places where the dead outnumbered the living, the emergence of burial pits and mass graves, and where there was no place to inter the dead. Therapeutic speculation and fantasy about the great pestilence was widespread, but medical knowledge in general was very limited in Western Europe during this time. Western Europeans were only beginning to translate Islamic medical manuscripts for more advanced knowledge. This is not to overlook the practice of quarantines and the development of the first Western European hospitals and medical schools. But in Europe, in the Dark Ages, there were many challenges to public health before the outbreak of the Great Pestilence. Overcrowding and poor sanitation assisted in the spread of the disease. There was only one burgeoning sense of public health, and this emanated from the clergy. There was no healthcare authority as we know it today. Of course, many of these hospitals were ineffective because, in addition to the state of medicine, care providers and patients died from the disease in great numbers, and hospital workers fled infected areas. Yet, given the rapid character of the pandemic, Western Europeans could have done little to reduce casualties. One basic understanding of disease was that it originated and was spread by bad odors. This was a time in European history when people still believed that pandemic disease, among other ailments, was literally spread by bad air or miasma, though this was not a modern understanding of airborne vectors. From the air, this was a poison that entered the body, and acquiring this poison could only have been the result of a sinful soul. This idea of malevolent air included a myriad of natural environmental factors. The notion that wind, mist, fogs, swamps, the sun, the heat, phenomena that potentially cause disease. Then there was the earth itself. The earth was seen as a living organism, a being that was supernatural and alive. Thus the earth, nature, the human body, and even the sun, moon, stars, and planets were considered sources of disease. They were carriers of toxins to the human body, especially infecting human blood. However, the main idea surrounding the appearance of the plague in Western Europe in 1347 was that an angry god ordained it, specifically as a punishment meted out to sinners. Ultimately, the plague was considered apocalyptic, an indication of the return of Jesus the Christ. The Great Plague was a manifestation of Eurasian intracontinental commerce. Routine trade, religious pilgrimage, and warring expeditions were vehicles for spreading the disease. After ravaging the cities of China, India, and Northern Africa, the plague moved on to Western Europe, principally to Messina in Sicily, and then swiftly throughout Italy, France, England, and then to Germany, Scandinavia, and Russia. Now, there were two notable forms of the disease, bubonic and pneumonic. The bubonic disease lived in fleas that infected rats, and through the rodent population, the fleas were able to travel vast distances on ships to infect people. And the people infected with the highly contagious disease showed the signs of a highly compromised immune system. And in addition to flu-like symptoms, the bacterium produced black swelling. In addition, across the land, the pneumonic form produced violent coughing and bloody hemorrhages. Other symptoms included fever and disorientation. People could expect to live, depending on the form contracted, between 2 days to a week. The plague moved through the continent suddenly. Hundreds of people died daily. People who could not flee the cities lived in anxiety with the dead. And most died within days of demonstrating symptoms of the plague, with anywhere from one quarter to one half of the population of Western Europe passing away, upwards to 70%. The graveyards were filled to capacity. Plague pits for mass burials were created outside of the cities. And as holy ground for burials disappeared because of the huge numbers of the dead, new lands to inter the bodies were blessed. And even the Rhone River in France was consecrated to house the dead. When the pestilence began to disappear in Western Europe, millions of people were dead. In a time often characterized by political chaos and social disorder, we can gain great understanding of the Great Plague and its aftermath. The plague attacked individuals and entire cities, churches, castles, and the homes of the humble peasants were shuttered and deserted. The plague affected animals as well as humans, and it manifested itself differently in various areas of the West as well as the eastern portions of the continent. The plague produced rapid depopulation, and prevailing wars added to the devastating effects of the disease. There was also increased lawlessness. Governments postponed, infrastructures left to decay or simply left unfinished, rises in the price of food, and falling property values. We see that when the world is upended by plague, it can bring out the best and the worst in people and societies. We see people banding together out of necessity to assist one another, particularly among the poor. The Great Pestilence was a turning point in European history. It signaled the end of the Dark Ages and the rise of Western Europe. It is one of the most important events in European history because it influenced all aspects of society. This included, for example, changes in the economy and the labor force, and the marked creation of plague art and literature, and the people's increased participation in religious zealousness, including such demonstrative religious expression as flagellation, self-mutilation, and the violent persecution and murder of selected peoples, such as the burning of Jews in Germany. In addition, we have evidence of the dancing fit, which appeared in some places where the plague continued to make its appearance. Years after the great pestilence peaked in Germany, the dance of Saint John appeared. This religious dance included leaping, shouting, and seemingly spirit possession. As the dancers exhibited hysteria, or in this case, a dance of ecstasy, convolutions followed. It was almost, as one historian put it, as if they were mocking death by imitating it. The bubonic plague was an extremely virulent disease. While Western feudal Europe was only a small portion of the Eurasian continent, it experienced profound consequences from the Great Plague. Yet how we discuss this particular plague within the context of world history is largely an essentialist proposition. As a pandemic, the bubonic plague was cataclysmic for Western Europe, mostly highlighting the great fatalities in England, while largely ignoring its continental historical impact in such areas as Mongolia and China. The bubonic plague had existed for thousands of years in Central Asia, and in the 6th and 7th centuries, the plague ravaged the Mediterranean. In the Byzantine Empire, the disease was known as the Plague of Justinian at the capital of Constantinople. The bubonic plague killed up to one half of the population in Cairo, Egypt, and North Africa, beginning in 1347. And disease-causing bacteria and viruses introduced by Europeans devastated Native American populations in the conquest of the New World. There are instances of strains of bubonic plague that continue to exist in the world today. The Great Pestilence reemerged in Western Europe until the 17th century. It appeared in other parts of the continent and the world until the 1950s. In the United States, the human plague has surfaced periodically, mostly on the West Coast since the 1970s, and treated with a complement of antibiotic drugs. And while we currently face important medical struggles with the Ebola virus in West Africa and the threat of global pandemic such as HIV/AIDS and the 2009 H1N1 influenza, plague continues to challenge humankind. We are concerned with the causes, how it spreads, and most of all, how to stop the disease. Like the great pestilence in the European Dark Ages, humanity's survival ultimately rests in our historical medical understanding, our collective expertise, and certainly in our imagination.